us observe the five first Saturdays as Our Lady of Fatima requested. This devotion consists of four parts, all of which should be made in a spirit of making reparation for blasphemies and ingratitude, and for peace in the world. First of all, to go to confession, generally within 8 days before or after the first Saturday of the month. Second, to receive Holy Communion on the first Saturday of the month. Third, to recite five decades of the Holy Rosary. And fourth, to meditate for 15 minutes on the mysteries of the Holy Rosary. So please join us coming up next for the Daily Mass and our EWTN family first Saturday devotions.
Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Kyrie eleison.
grant, Almighty God, that we may celebrate with heartfelt devotion these days of joy, which we keep in honor of the risen Lord, and that what we relive in remembrance, we may always hold to in what we do. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Paul reached also Derbe and Lystra, where there was a disciple named Timothy, the son of a Jewish woman who was a believer, but his father was a Greek. The brothers in Lystra and Iconium spoke highly of him, and Paul wanted him to come along with him. On account of the Jews of that region, Paul had him circumcised, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. As they traveled from city to city, they handed on to the people for observation the decisions reached by the apostles and presbyters in Jerusalem. Day after day, the churches grew stronger in faith and increased in number. They traveled through the Phrygian and Galatian territory because they had been prevented by the Holy Spirit from preaching the message in the province of Asia. When they came to Mysia, they tried to go on into Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them. So they crossed through Mysia and came down to Troas. During the night, Paul had a vision. A Macedonian stood before him and implored him with these words, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." When he had seen the vision, we sought passage to Macedonia at once, concluding that God had called us to proclaim the good news to them. Sing joyfully to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful song. Know that the Lord is God. He made us, his we are. His people, the flock he tends. The Lord is good. His kindness endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations.
Jesus said to his disciples, "If the world hates you, realize that it hated me first. If you belong to the world would love its own. But because you do not belong to the world, and I have chosen you out of the world hates you. Remember the word I spoke to you, no slave is greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will also keep yours. And they will do all these things to you on account of my name, because they do not know the one who sent me. Ergum Domini. To first look at briefly at something mentioned in the first reading from the Acts of the Apostles, and this word that the apostles had been prevented by the Holy Spirit from preaching the message in a certain area. So the Spirit directed them to go to certain places and not to others. And as believers, we want to be so attuned to the movement of the Holy Spirit to know where it is that he's leading us, and that we are that docile to follow him, and then also when to speak and when not to speak. I think many times we always think the Holy Spirit is moving in a way that we're supposed to be proclaiming something constantly. And sometimes the Spirit is saying, speak. And sometimes the Spirit is saying, shh. And keep that in mind, that when we listen to him, sometimes even in our families, or sometimes when we encounter friends, there are moments when we are to speak to them and invite them and challenge them. And there are other moments that the Holy Spirit is saying, I'll use someone else. You're not going to be the instrument that I use to speak to them. So as we continue to give witness to the gospel by our life of charity, this is always, we have to live this way in imitation of Christ, but our words, again, to know when the Holy Spirit is asking us to speak. And just to give a witness of his the movement and our response to him. We encounter as priests many individuals who will say, you know, they come to confession, they ring the bell, or they come here to confession, and they often will start out by telling us that if they've been away for a while, you know, I had a father been wanting to come for a long time, or I don't know, I just decided to come today. You know? And we always look at that in terms of feeling very guilty, you know, we're this evil, horrible person who's waited 2 years to come to confession. And you are an evil, horrible person if you wait that long. But a lot of times the thing that we overlook is what made you come today? What is it that all of a sudden, why today and not 6 months ago? Or why today and not 3 months from now? We never really know. It's like, well, I've been thinking about it for a while, and I had the time, and I decided today I'm just going to do it. And it's important for us in those moments to realize, and I would say this for all of us, we all have an experience. I'm just using confession as an example, but we all have some experience that, you know, could relate to. But that these individuals recognize, you know what, the Spirit has been prompting me. The Spirit has been moving in my life and inviting me. And the Spirit has been preparing me for that encounter. So maybe, you know, 2 months ago, I just wasn't ready to respond. I needed to respond. I mean, let me make that clear. But pastor, we need to respond to the Spirit, especially that he's calling us to be reconciled, you know, with Christ. But all of a sudden there's that movement that happens that we can't always explain, that we say, well, I had the time today and I decided to do it. This is a soul that is responding to this invitation, this prompting, this movement of the Spirit. God never leaves us alone. You know, we speak of him as this hound of heaven or someone that's chasing after us. But if we look at the Holy Spirit, he's out, he's just there, he's moving. He's massaging our heart, you might say. He's this stream of living water pouring over the hardness of our heart, trying to open that up. And at a certain point, he prevails. And so it's important for us to recognize, even in that moment, I've been away from the sacrament for 2 years, for 5 years, for 10. And what made me come today? But the Spirit gave me the invitation, and I finally responded. Now, so a recognition that the Spirit is at work, and that we are responding to him maybe a little bit more than we realize. So be encouraged in that, and continue to ask the Spirit for that gift. As we move towards Pentecost, ask Jesus to help us, you know, receive this gift that he wishes to give us, and to be responsive to this gift that he gives us, this gift of the Holy Spirit, to ask the Holy Spirit himself, Lord, help me to hear you and to respond to you, you know, that I'm so perfectly attuned to you. This is what we want to be as believers. You'll be amazed at what the Holy Spirit does in your life. A passage from, or a quote from St. Gregory the Great regarding the gospel today. He says this: the hostility of the perverse sounds like praise for our life. The hostility of the perverse sounds like praise for our life. When you try, brothers and sisters, to live according to the Holy Spirit and live the life of Jesus alive in you, the world will hate you. Now, most of us don't wake up in the morning with an idea that it's great to be hated. You know, we work very much to be liked. We all want to fit in, whether we're young, middle-aged, or old. There, I've never met one person that says, oh, I don't mind being hated. Now, let's be honest. We all kind of say, I don't want to be separated from anyone else. I don't want to be despised by anyone. And so I'll work very hard to be liked. And yet, Jesus is saying, you know, that's the trend of the world, but I have taken you out of the world. And so this, when we try to live the life of Christ, we recognize he was despised, and so I will be despised. These are his very words to us. The world hated me, so guess what? The world's going to hate you because you're living my life. You're preaching my gospel. And so in order to live the life of Christ, you know, we work counter-cultural, or work contrary to our natural tendency. Our natural tendency is to just fit in. So as we try to live the life of Christ, we sometimes put that aside or downplay it, or, and yet we find that we're very unhappy in that. We find peace, or we find joy in the moments when we recognize, no, I'm living that I'm pleasing to the Lord, and maybe I'm unpleasant in the eyes of the world. Maybe my neighbor doesn't care for me. Again, we can set, it hurts, but we set that aside saying, but I want to be the one who's pleasing in God's eyes first. So again, this is what St. Gregory says. This hostility of the perverse sounds like praise for our life, because it shows that we have at least some rectitude if we are an annoyance to those who do not love God. No one can be pleasing to God and to God's enemies at the same time. He who seeks to please those who oppose God is no friend of God. And he who submits himself to the truth will fight against those who strive against the truth. So, when the world hates us, we can have a little degree of confidence that we know that, you know, we're an annoyance to those who are not on the path of the Lord. It's the only time you can annoy somebody, you know, get under someone's skin. Because, yes, I'm preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm living the life of Jesus Christ, and it drives you crazy, you know. When we recognize that, we shouldn't lose peace. We recognize, well, it means it gives me an assurance I'm doing something right. You know, so if you're told to leave or get out or shut your, you know, among your family members, it's usually a sign, well, it means I'm following Christ. We usually, again, that's not the natural feeling we have. We have to remind ourselves of this. Why? Because when Christ came, when the Word became flesh, we had this apparition among us, or this presence among us of divine charity. And the world's natural response to that was going to be hatred. Because darkness doesn't really receive light very well. The darkness doesn't love light or embrace light. Just look at how we operate naturally. Somebody walks in the middle of the night and clicks the light on. What's our response? Is our very body, you know, repelled or moves against that? We squint against that. It's not the same when somebody shuts the light off. We don't have this violent response. But this is how, at a spiritual level, how the world responds. You know, when the world lives in lies, it doesn't want to embrace the truth. And so there is this natural hatred. When St. John is writing his gospel, the persecution of Christians is in full force. And so St. John writes, some of the commentators tell us, in very black and white terms, and that's what we hear in the gospel today. But St. John was very well aware of what Jesus said, that you're not of this world. You have to live in the world, but you're not of the world, because I've called you out of the world. And so what the Christians were doing is, you had this vast Roman Empire, and the Christians were not trying to take down the Roman Empire. They benefited from all the good things that came from Roman authority. You know, there were roadways, there was infrastructure that was put in place. There was a general peace among the people because they just weren't subject to any kind of attack or violation. They had some sort of protection. But what had happened over the course of time, even the Roman emperor initially rejected this idea, but Rome is named after this goddess, or this spirit of Rome, and they believe that that spirit took its kind of possessed or had its dwelling place in the emperor to a degree. And so a certain number of the people under Roman authority began to look at the emperor as a god. And like I said, initially the emperor pushed that aside, but over the course of time, they realized, the Roman authorities realized, this could work to their advantage. And so what was happening by this time is that everybody once a year needed to acknowledge this divine authority of the emperor. And so they had to present themselves in their local vicinities and take a pinch of incense and, you know, throw it on the coals and make some sort of profession of acknowledgement of this divinity of the emperor. Now, for the pagans, they had all kinds of gods, and the Roman authorities could have cared less if they had some kind of worship of these different gods, as long as they did this profession, I dare say profession of faith, this acknowledgement of the divine authority of the emperor. and let that have primacy. So then it comes along these Christians. But what goes on in their life? They don't have all these gods. They knew through Jesus Christ that there is one God, and that no one has authority or dominion or power over that one God. That God has primacy in our heart and in our life. And so the Christian would not offer this sacrifice of incense. And so they made themselves a target. They were viewed as this rebellious group, and all this, the way they were viewed, very misled, taking aspects of Christian doctrine and really skewing that. You know, they're accused of being cannibals, of being these people who believed in fire because they believed in the end times, that God would come in glory and bring purification to the world. So they were always associated with anything evil or bad. The Christians greeted one another with a kiss of peace. And of course, this was distorted into them being somehow an extremely immoral people, quite the opposite of who they were. And so, when John is writing his gospel, he is seeing this in full force, that the Christians are being persecuted for living their faith. And that's what we hear in this account, the words of Christ reminding them, strengthening them, that you're not of this world and that you're going to be hated in this world and that you have to live in this world, but I've called you out of that world, and that's why you endure this persecution. So on this first Saturday of the month, call upon our Blessed Mother to strengthen you, but understand that. Let us all embrace that in our life and ask the Holy Spirit for strength. When I am a believer in Jesus Christ, it means the cross. It means persecution. There ain't no way around it. We offer our petitions.
Let the power of the Holy Spirit be at work in our Holy Father and all his endeavors and plans for the spread of the gospel and the sanctification of God's people. We pray to the Lord. That the leaders of nations may unite in a worldwide effort to provide daily bread for those who are starving. We pray to the Lord. That those who find their pregnancy a difficult trial to bear may gain strength from the love of God. We pray to the Lord. For those who are threatened with unemployment, that through the intercession of Saint Joseph, they may find new means to support their families and dependents. We pray to the Lord. That our departed relatives and friends may soon be welcomed into the heavenly home prepared for them from all eternity. We pray to the Lord.
We pray for the guidance of the Holy Spirit, for our president and our government leaders and their efforts with North Korea, that they may secure an agreement of peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Father in heaven, we offer these our intentions through the hands of our Blessed Mother, and we ask them in the name of Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
Lord of God, Lord of God,
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty. Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of all his holy church.
Accept in compassion, Lord, we pray, the offerings of your family, that under your protective care they may never lose what they have received, but attain the gifts that are eternal. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. Through him the children of light rise to eternal life, and the halls of the heavenly kingdom are thrown open to the faithful. For his death is our ransom from death, and in his rising the life of all has risen. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of Mysterium Fidei. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Francis, St. Clair, St. Anthony, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Robert, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
The Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we hear to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
One who stays.
Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. Father, I pray for them, that they may be one in us, so that the world may believe it was you who sent me, says the Lord. Alleluia.
Those who cannot now receive Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament, we offer the following prayer. My dear Lord and Savior, though I am but a sinful servant, I approach thee with confidence. I am truly sorry for having offended thee by my sins, because thou art infinitely good. I have a great desire to receive thee in Holy Communion, and since I cannot now be united to thee in the Blessed Sacrament, I beseech thee most earnestly to come to me at least spiritually, and to refresh my soul with the sweetness of thy grace. Come, my Lord, my God, and my all, come to me, and let me never again be separated from thee by sin. I wish to become like thee. Teach me thy blessed ways. Help me with thy grace to practice meekness, humility, purity, charity, and all the virtues of thy sacred heart. O my Jesus, I consecrate to thee my heart with all its affections, my soul with all its powers, and my body with all its senses. In union with thee, I will live and labor and suffer to do the Heavenly Father's will. I will ever be mindful of the presence of my God and strive to be perfect. Bless me in life and in death, that I may praise thee forever in heaven. Amen.
Celestibus, novum melos pangibus.
us pray. Keep safe, O Lord, we pray, those whom you have saved by your kindness, that redeemed by the passion of your Son, they may rejoice in his resurrection, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Benedictus spiritus.
Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
Ite missa est.
Deo gratias.
In order to make the five first Saturdays devotion which Our Lady of Fatima requested, we now pray the joyful mysteries of the Holy Rosary with the intention of making reparation to the Immaculate Heart of Mary for the offenses against her, especially offenses against her Immaculate Conception. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. Persecuted Christians and the enemies of the Church. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen.
For an increase in faith, hope, and charity, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The first joyful mystery, the Annunciation.
The angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, Hail, full of grace, the Lord is with you. At first, the archangel Gabriel does not call the virgin by her name, but rather by that which best describes her. He says, "Hail, full of grace." Mary is the Immaculate Conception, and on this first of the five first Saturdays, we make reparation for the offenses against her Immaculate Conception, seeking to make reparation for those who deny it or reject it, for those who blaspheme God's work in her, and for those who attack her privileges. Conversely, we proclaim with love and gratitude the truth that Mary is the Immaculate Conception, the Virgin full of grace, who was sinless from the first moment of her conception.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
O my Jesus,
forgive us our sins, save us from the fires of hell, lead all souls to heaven, especially those who most need thy mercy.
Ave. Second joyful mystery, the Visitation.
Gabriel said, "And behold, your kinswoman Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month."
I love how you put it, that the initial call is to be the best version of yourself. It's a human call. It's universal. Secondarily, you find different forms or expressions for this, but the fundamental driving need is to conform yourself to
right.
God.
Yes, at one, I am sure of it, that God has a plan for each person.
Yeah.
I mean, I ended up teaching at a seminary. I was a factory operator. Never in my wildest dreams did I expect that I would teach at a seminary
yes.
and do the work that I'm doing. I didn't even know if I could write papers or teach or, you know, so although I taught in a business school for a number of years too, but I mean, you know, one has to discover and uncover by following indications sent to me by God, often through other people. Here's where you should go. And then at a certain point you find what your greatest desire is.
Yeah.
And how you can serve. And then you bloom. I love this quote from Colossians 3:23. The context is a little iffy, but Paul says there, whatever you do, do it with all your heart.
Right.
And you know, every single job, and to the younger people that are watching this, take every job you get seriously, because you will learn who you are by how you relate to that work. When I was a production operator, I tried to be the best production operator I could be. And what one finds is what John Paul speaks about is this distinction between a subjective and objective dimension of work. No matter what job you're doing, what John Paul says, no matter what the objective results are, whether it's earning you lots of money or not very much, whether you're a garbage collector, a factory operator, or a CEO, or a professor, the thing that gives work its dignity is the fact that the one who is doing it is a person.
Yeah, the element of intentionality, like the little child you've inculcated with this need and skill to put the fork